In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
Our Father and our God, we thank you for the privilege you've given unto us to come once again into your presence and be fed by your word. Lord, as we come this very day, I pray that you will break this bread of life unto us.
Amen.
And you will give us the grace that we will be able to comprehend, to understand all what you are saying to us today, so that we can go out from here and begin to practice all these things, Lord, in our lives, in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Help us, Lord, that we not be dull of hearing,
Amen.
But that give us the grace that we understand your word, and we will receive this word as the word of God, not as the word of any man, in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Spirit of the living God, breathe this word into our soul, into our spirits, and into our heart, even today, in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Thank you, Father, because you've had an answer. Worship and we exalt your name, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
Amen. Praise the Lord. Shall we be seated, please? This afternoon in our Sunday message, we are considering the message titled, The Christian in the Workplace. The Christian in the Workplace. If you go back again to our memory verse that we consider from our side, for our side of scriptures today, where we'll be taking our lead text form for the message, Ruth chapter 2. Ruth chapter 2. I'll just read verse 12 for now. The Lord recompense thy work, and a full reward be given thee of the Lord God of Israel, under whose wings thou hast come to trust. You will see the mention of the word there, work. The Lord recompense thy work. And then he says, a full reward be given unto thee of the Lord God. You know, most times as Christians, when we go to our places of work, we always think that we are being paid what we work for. That may be correct. That may be right. But as a believer, you need to know that you are not just working for that employer here on earth. The Lord has called you into that workplace so that you can demonstrate and live the life of a Christian. You see the example of Ruth from our text where we've read. She demonstrated an example of Christian piety and hard work that we as believers should show in our places of work today. Not only that, you will see that Ruth showed unto us from this passage of scriptures that hard work is rewarding and satisfying as well. That's why the Lord is calling us today. She took up the determination. She took up the courage, like we are told by our pastor during the time of the summary. You know, to go out there. You see that in verse 2. In verse 2 of our text, Ruth chapter 2. And Ruth, the Moabitess, said unto Naomi, that's her mother-in-law, let me now go to the field, instead of sitting at home idle, instead of sitting at home wasting time, instead of sitting at home lazy about, let me go into the field and glean ears of corn, after him in whose sight I shall find grace. And Naomi told her, go, my daughter. You see, she came into Bethlehem, Judah, at the time of the harvest. That's the barley harvest. And it was a busy period. It was a time of harvesting, and would say, instead of me wasting time, instead of me just sitting at home doing nothing, this is the time of weeping. This is harvesting time. Let me go into the field and work with my hands so that I can earn something to support myself. What an example of hard work, of diligence we'll see in the life of Ruth. We need to know that as Christians likewise, the Lord is calling us that we also, we should demonstrate this virtue. We'll see in the lives of Ruth today, in Matthew chapter 5. Matthew chapter 5. These are the very words of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Look at what he told us in Matthew chapter 5. I'll read from verse 13. Ye are the salt of the earth. But if the salt has lost its savor, wherein shall it be salted? It is henceforth good for nothing, but to be cast out, and to be trodden under the foot of men. Ye are the light of the world. A city that is set on an hill cannot be hidden. Neither do men light a candle and put it under the bosom, but on a candlestick, and it giveth light unto all that are in the house. Look at the conclusion in verse 16. Let your light so shine before men. My brothers, my sisters, we just came back from the retreat. What an opportunity to sit at the feet of the Lord Jesus Christ at the retreat, heirs of the kingdom. And we've learned so much from our Father in the Lord and also from all the other ministers at our regional headquarters during the retreat. You know, there is the temptation that, oh, we need to continue to stay together, to abide together. But no, it's not like that. The Lord has called us as Christians that we need to go out there in the field. Look at Ruth from our text where we've read. She just came into the land, and as a stranger, a Moabite in Bethlehem, Judah, you know, she needed to study the environment. She needed time, but she knew that she had no time. That this is harvesting time. This is the time of the barley harvest. I cannot waste time. And she told her mother-in-law, yes, I'm a widow, but we cannot continue to sit like this. Let me go out there into the field. The same thing the Lord is telling us. We have a responsibility. You cannot sit in the church all the days of your life. Like we are here now for Sunday. We are just here for just three hours. Then we are off. You need to go back to your houses. You need to go back to your neighborhood. Not only that, you need to go out there and relate with the other men, the men, the women, those people you meet on the road. That's why the Lord says, let your light so shine before men. The Christian in the workplace. We need to understand that as Christians, we are called to shine the light everywhere we are and to demonstrate the true life of Christ, not only in the church, but at home and also in your profession. Let your light so shine before men, that they may see your good works and glorify your Father which is in heaven. We need to know that the necessity of living a Christian life, a holy life, wherever we are, in whatever thing we do on earth here, cannot be overemphasized. When we look at the workplace of today, you see a lot of people engaged in all kinds of ungodliness, all kinds of dishonesty, all kinds of unholy practices, ungodliness, unethical business decisions can characterize many places of work today. But the Lord is calling us that as Christians, if you say you know the Lord, we just came back from the retreat. If you say you've had an encounter with the Lord at the retreat, the Lord is expecting that as you go out here, you need to demonstrate the virtue of a Christian, even in your profession. What kind of virtue? Like we learned in the life of Ruth today, Christian piety and hard work. We need to know you cannot separate your secular life from your Christian profession. Do you understand? You cannot separate your profession out there in the world from your Christian possession in Christ our Lord and Savior. What do we mean by that? He was saying that whatever thing you do in that place of war, in whatever profession you are pursuing in life, if you say you have possessed Christian experiences, salvation, sanctification, Holy Ghost baptism, and other Christian virtues, the Lord is saying, you cannot separate those Christian virtues from what you are doing in that place of work. They all go together. Look at Ruth. When she came to Bethlehem, Judah, she knew that she has taken the decision to abandon her idols. She has taken the decision to abandon her strange gods, to come into a strange land. And then when she came into that strange land, she went with that same consciousness, the piety of a Christian, that a believer ought to demonstrate. And she put her hands to work. She put her hands to work. So the Lord is calling us. We need to demonstrate whatever Christian experience you've gotten. Salvation, go out there, let them see the salvation in you. You say you are sanctified, go out there, let them see the manifestation of that sanctification experience in you. You say you've gotten the Holy Ghost baptism, go out there and demonstrate it, let them see it in you. Let your light so shine before men. That's what Christ said. We need to let it shine. We cannot hide our Christian profession. We cannot bring our Christian possession under a bushel and say, well, in this place of work, I don't want them to know me as a Christian. You must be known if you are a true Christian. That's what we are learning, we are talking about today. The Christian in the workplace. For better understanding, we want to consider this message under three subheadings. Point one, we consider the crooked characteristics of workers today. What are the things we see being shown by people out there in the world? Then point two, we consider the Christian conduct at work. The Christian conduct at work. And lastly, before we pray, we consider Christ's commendation of the worthy. Christ's commendation of the worthy. Let's go straight to point one. You look at the characteristics today. Why did the Lord say, let your light so shine before men? Why did the Lord say, we are the light of the world? Why did the Lord say that we need to allow our life, our profession, to match our lifestyle, our conduct in the world around us? Why did he say that? You go back again to the example of Ruth that we are considering. Ruth chapter 2. You see this woman, Ruth? She was a widow. And when she came, look at that in Ruth chapter 2. Ruth chapter 2. In verse 2. And Ruth, the Moabite, said unto Naomi, let me now go to the field of harvesting. The field there for Ruth represents the field of harvesting, where they are harvesting the, you know, the bearing time, the bearing fruit, because it was at the time of the bearing harvest. You know, that was the representation of the field for her. And then that place is not just for her alone. There are a lot of people there. But look at what she said. And glean ears of corn after him in whose sight I shall do what? I shall do what? Find grace. Why did she say that? She knew that in the field of him, there are some feet that is not of grace. There are some feet that is full of wickedness. There are some feet, some places of war. There are some feet for her that she cannot go to because of the corrupt practices. That's why I say, let me go to the feet of whom I will find grace. Because there are some owners of the feet, you cannot find grace in their sight. The grace there for her and taste means favor. Do you understand? Where am I found favor? Somebody might permit me and say, oh, let me claim from this field. That was what it is for her, the field here. And Naomi said unto her, go, my daughter. Why do we say that today? Because, like I said, there are some field that are graceless. When you look at Proverbs chapter 18, that's why we are considering this point one, crooked characteristics of workers today. You see a lot of evil practices in places of war. You see a lot of corrupt practices in so-called workplaces today. Proverbs chapter 18. What are some of the characteristics of the wicked, of the graceless? What are the things you see in the lives of those that have not the grace of God in their life? Look at Proverbs chapter 18, let's see verse 9. He that is slothful in his work. Do you see that in your Bible? He that is slothful in his work is brother to him that is a great what? Waster. What do you see in some places of work today? Slothfulness. Idleness. Time wasting. Corrupt practices. Unethical business decisions. You know, bribery and corruptions. Falsifying of accounts. When they want to return their tax at the end of the tax year, they try to change the records. These are some of the crooked practices. And not only that, you see in Proverbs 26, what are some of the other characteristics? From where we've read, it talks about slothfulness. Workers are slothful. You say, you expect workers to work for 8 hours. 7 hours. But then you see, out of that 7 hours, they've spent almost half of the hours in slothfulness, wasting of time, in things that are not related to the official duties, wasting time. That's why the Bible says, it's a brother to whom that is a great waster. In Proverbs chapter 26, Proverbs chapter 26, verse 14, it says, as the dove turneth upon his hinges, so doeth the slothful upon his what? His bed. You see, workers, They expected to resume at work by 8 a.m. 7:30, they are still rolling on their bed. That's what the Bible says. It says, as I look at the door, you see the hinges of the door. You can switch the door in here as long as that door is, you know, being held by the hinges. The same thing, when they're on their bed, they turn to the right, the alarm clock tried to wake them up. They say, oh, alarm clock is not yet time now. They close the alarm and turn to the left. Sleep with the right, turn to, you see, wasting of time, slothfulness. So he's a slothful upon his bed, not excited to go to work. They don't know how can I continue to kill myself in this place of work. I cannot, you know, give all my energy. Then why are you working? The Bible says here, the crooked characteristics of workers, wasting time. What they need to do at the right time, they'll just be intentionally delaying it, wasting time. Crooked characteristics of workers today. Proverbs chapter 21, look at what the Bible also says. Proverbs chapter 21, verse 6. The getting of treasures by a lying tongue is a vanity tossed to and fro of them that seeketh death. Crooked characteristics, lying tongues. You see them, workmen, skilled workers, you call them and say, how much will it take to fix this kitchen? They will go to the market, go to the shops, they will get the thing maybe for £10, but because they want to make unlawful gains, they will double the amount and come to the customer and say, actually, do you know that thing is £20? Lying tongues. Lying tongues. You see, that's what the Bible says there. You don't make unlawful gain. Yes, you are a skilled worker, you are supposed to make profit. But if you must make profit, you make reasonable profit. Not that when you try and, you know, you try and repair the, you know, the toilet and things like that, you know that thing you are doing, the materials you have used are of inferior quality, that it will not last. Lying tongue, deception. You see that in the workplace today. You see, people, they expected to work 8 hours or 9 hours a day or 8 hours, 30 minutes a day, and they will come to the office and they will not do their normal work time. And they will just go home like that, lying tongue. And at the end of the week, if they are giving their time sheet, they will say they work for 8 hours. When you know that actually you did not work for 8 hours that day. Yes, there are some places where there is flexibility of time. Do you understand? But you know what is expected of you, the number of hours you are expected to work in a day or in a week or in a month. You want to meet up. That's what the Lord is calling us to, that we don't join in line. So you see some people today, come on, just little edit. They will phone the office and say, sorry, I am off sick today. The following week, I am not sick. Every week, they will be sick. Every month, they will be sick. Lying tongues. Lying tongues. Lying tongues. I pray that will not be our characteristics in Jesus' name. Workers here include the semi-skilled workers, the self-employed, like the skilled workers I've mentioned, carpenters, the plumbers, the builders, or those who serve in the shopping mall, or those who are employed by one man business, or you are working with somebody in partnership. You know, those are the workers we are talking about. Or those who are even working in state corporation. You work for the NHS, Grampian. Or you work in the schools. You know, or you work in a big establishment. All kinds of whatever thing you are doing. Can I tell you? The Lord is calling. Because whatever thing you do in that place of work, there are other people that are also doing the same thing. Do you know that? Do you know that? Whatever, either you're a care worker, there are others too that are also involved in care, as carers. Or you are involved as an engineer. There are others also that are called engineers. But do you know that the difference between a born-again Christian and the other worker is your behavior, your attitude to that work, your character, you understanding that you are not just working for your employer, but you are also working for God. Do you know that? That God is your first employer as a Christian and not that company that pays your salary. That's what you need to know. Whatever thing you do in life, that's what the Bible says, in everything we do, do it as unto the Lord. I pray the Lord will help us in Jesus' name. Brethren, there are so much crookedness, dishonesty in the places of work today. Look at Amos chapter 5, crooked characteristics of workers. Amos chapter 5. I will read verse 12 of Amos chapter 5. For I know your manifold transgressions and your mighty sins. They afflict the just. They take a bribe. Do you see that? They take a bribe. Bribery and corruption. They take a bribe. They take kickbacks. There are some organizations that have made it as a kind of policy. Any gift more than maybe £50 or $50, you need to declare it. You are not expected to take such a gift. But what do you see today? You see people, because they want to influence a contract, they'll say, oh, come, let me take you out for dinner. Why are you taking me out for dinner? Because you want to influence my decision of awarding the contract, I will not go. But you see, a lot of people do that. They take things that they are not expected to take. So we'll give you an holiday in the Caribbean. Or because you know that individual sits in the panel of decisions of those that will award the contract. Corrupt practices taking place in the place of work today. You see people, they will go and meet the manufacturer and say, well, do you know what? Because I want to do a mass production, can we reduce the quality of this product so that we can produce more and give more? And that thing they are giving, and they will still sell it at the same price of the quality one. Corrupt practices. Corruption. Look at what the Bible says. Manifold transgressions. Have you not seen immorality taking place in places of work? That lady that used to love her husband before, when he gets to that office, you see another man that is now eyeing her, that is taking her away from the husband. Immorality. Adultery, fornication, lying, stealing. How about people that take company's property and use it for their own benefit? And use it, they are working for the company, quite all right, but as they are working, they are also using the property of the business of the company to do their own business. Corrupt practices taking place in the places of work. I pray that will not be your Lord in Jesus' name. I didn't hear your amen.
Amen.
You know, let me summarize this. What are the things you see? 9 of them quickly. Number 1, iniquity. Taking place in places of work. Iniquity, sin of all kinds. Number 2, idleness. Crooked characteristics, idleness. They come to work instead of attending to the emails that are urgent, the work that are urgent. Right in the office, they are going on Facebook. Right in the office, they are tutoring. Right in the office, they are wasting. And you ask yourself, that time you use for Facebooking, that time you use for Twitter, that time you use in posting those pictures on the Instagram, you are using official time doing all those things. That's corrupt practices. If you say you are a Christian, you are not supposed to do that. You see, well, for me, don't you see others? You know, you see some people, even in their place of work, the number of breaks they take, and they call it, you know, some they call it coffee breaks. If you add everything together, it's almost 2 hours out of 8 hours. Corrupt practices, idleness, wasting time, gossiping, using the place of war. You see, number three, indolence. Initiation, number four, no, lack of activity. They go, they nothing to search for the day. What are the things you want to achieve for the day? Nothing. And just here to mark 8 hours. Inactivity. You don't do that in the place of war. Number five, you see idolatry. They bring idol worship even into the place of war. They bring idol. In the, go to their office, they have a particular idol here that they've set up, that they worship. Crooked characteristics of workers today. Not only the employers will even try to force the employees and say, well, this is the kind of idols we worship here and you must all bow to this idol. We do sacrifice. We don't do that as Christians. What do you see? Indulgence. Number six, indulgence. Instead of attending to fights, instead of attending to matters, instead of attending to that care, that carer, that person you are caring for, you just waste time. The person needs your help. The person knows you are being paid to care for her or to care for him, and you are just lazing about. Number seven, immorality. Number eight, impropriety. And then number nine, injustice. Don't you see employers oppressing employees? We not give them their own, you know, due rewards on time. Injustice. Don't you see that in the places of work today? Just because you are a Christian, and they will delay your promotion. They will sit on it. And that employer will just hate you. Does that mean that you as Christian, you have to react? You don't react. You need the vengeance in the hands of God. I pray the Lord will help us. Now, what should be our conduct as Christians in our places of work? Having seen the crooked characteristics, what are we expected to demonstrate? If we say we are Christian, like we see in the life of Ruth, this leads us to point two, Christian conduct at work. Christian conduct at work. If you go back to our text in Ruth chapter 2, Ruth chapter 2, in verse 3, look at the conduct of a Christian. And she went and came into the field. And what did the Bible say? Are you there? Ruth chapter 2, verse 3. Are you there with me now? Now let's see it together. And she went and came. And what did she do? Was she going about gossiping? Telling stories? I said, do you know what? I'm a Moabite. I just came from Moab. Do you know what? Do you know the kind of... Was that what she was doing? When she got to the field, when she got to her place of work, what was she doing? She gleaned in the field. Hard work. That should be her conduct. Place of work is not for gossiping. It's not for backbiting. It's not for idleness. It's not for iniquity. It's not for immorality. Where you earn your salary, you must work for it as a Christian. That's what Ruth is teaching us here in this passage. She went to the field and she gleaned in the field after the reapers. After the reapers, she gleaned. And then no wonder in the, I'll come to read that later, but she gleaned. You see, in the life of Ruth there as Christian, the Lord expects us to be hardworking. That's the condo. Hardworking. And the, you know, there are some organizations, they set objectives, goals. At the beginning of every year, you as Christian, you're expected to set your goal. What are the things you need to achieve for that organization, for that year? You need to set it. Don't wait till your employer or your manager tells you, once these are the goals. You set your own objective. What are the things you want to achieve to demonstrate that you're an hardworking employee? That's what we are learning from Ruth there. That every day you go to that office should count for you. that you don't just go and come back and the day is not counting. The hours are wasted. You can't point to something tangible that you have achieved in the office for that day. 2 Thessalonians, Christian conduct at work. 2 Thessalonians chapter 3. Chapter 3 of 2 Thessalonians. I'll read from verse 10. What should be our conduct? He says, for even when we were with you, this we commanded you, that if any will not walk, neither should he do what? Eat. If any. Yes, an apostle talking. He says, if any. As Christians, the Lord don't expect us to be beggars on the streets. No, not at all. He expects us to walk. He expects us to labor. He expects us to use our hand. Paul the apostle said, this is an apostle. And you know, this is an apostle. He did not say, oh, I'm an apostle. I will not walk. No, he was given to walk himself. He was a tent maker. That's why I say this we commanded for in verse 11. For we hear that there are some which walk among you disorderly. Christians don't walk disorderly. As Christians, we are not rebellious to our superiors, to our managers. They might oppress us. That doesn't mean you begin to walk disorderly. You begin to disobey them. You begin to disregard their instructions. You begin to do your own thing. No, we don't do that in our places of work. Even in the church of the living God, we don't show disobedience to leadership. As we said, we don't walk disorderly. When you are given instruction in that place of work, we don't join in carrying placards. We don't join in picketing. That no, today we must picket this company. No, today I'm part of the labor union and we must fight for our rights. Christians don't fight for their rights. Do you know that? We allow God to fight for us as Christians. He said, we don't walk disorderly. We are obedient, submissive to leadership. Leadership in the church and leadership even in our places of war. That your manager may be a drunkard. He may be a chronic sinner, but as long as he's still your manager, you are expected to be obedient to him or her. Disorderly, walking not at all, but a busybody. Now, you look at verse 12 now. What should be our conduct at war? It says, now, them that are such, we command and exhort by our Lord Jesus Christ, that with quietness, they do what? I do. What did the Bible say? They walk. Do you know, walk don't key. It's idleness that keys. Walk, no matter hard work, don't kiss. People say, oh, when you walk, you will die young. It's not like that. You know, one day, while we were doing evangelism on the street, I came across, I think the man should be in his 80s. Here in this city of Aberdeen, here even in Torrey, should be in his 80s. And he was still going to his security job. I was surprised. I was shocked. A man at 80, still working. I read another story of another man, a pensioner. I think this one was even in his 70s. He was so bored at home. He was a pensioner. He had to start applying for jobs. I said, look, I'm not doing anything. It's making me, almost turning me dead. I need to work. And he went there. And you know, somebody had to employ him. When he saw his advert, his request to be employed, he says, they walk. We're expected to walk. Not to sit idle. Not to be indolent. Not to be lazy about. The Lord expects us to walk. The Lord expects us, and we are going to walk. Tell your neighbor, you will walk. Look at the way you are talking to your neighbor. You will walk, and the Lord will bless our walk in Jesus' name. That was what Ruth did. She went away. She said, let me go out and walk. Let me not depend on the social system. And you allow the system, you know, in fact, the government is even making it harder now with this universal credit. You say, well, I want the system to sponsor me. The system now is, what they even give you does not even take care of you for a month. We ought to work, brethren. We must not be people that are depending on the government. I pray the Lord will help us in Jesus' name. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 11. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 11. And that you study to be quiet. Christian, we are quiet. We are not lousy. In our places of work, we are not lousy. You are not the one making noise all the time. In the world. You concentrate on your work. He says, and ye study to be quiet and to do your own business. To do your own business and to work with your own hands as we commanded you. Do your own business. You say, oh, I'm applying for a job. I've not got a job. Why don't you go into self-employment? There are a lot you can do, even in this city of Aberdeen. There are a lot. I pray God will open our eyes to see the opportunities, vast opportunities that are all lying before us. Not everybody can work in oil company. Not everybody can work in the banking institution. Not everybody can even work in the NHS. We can do something with our own hands. He says, let them do their own. You can do your own business. You can be a self-employed person. You can have your own business. You can have your own work that you are doing and it's bringing something and you are earning your living through that. The beginning may be rough. I'm telling you, to set up a business, the beginning is not always rosy. Go and learn from even established billionaires, established millionaires today. Look at what they are facing, the challenges they are facing. You see the social media person that is facing some challenges already. So business, to have your own business, is not always rosy at times. But yet the Lord commands us to walk, and we will walk. Amen. I say, and we will walk. Amen. And to walk with your own hands. Walk with your own hands. Walk with it. God gave you two hands, walk with it. God gave you two legs, walk with it. God gave you a brain, use your brain. Don't sit idle all the time. If you cannot get a job, go for further education. That can give you something. That can give, you know, get a further degree. That can give you a good prospect in securing another, a better job. Work. Do something. That's what we are learning today. And the Lord himself will bless us mightily in Jesus' name. In 1 Peter chapter 2. Open your Bible quickly to 1 Peter chapter 2. Chapter 2 of 1 Peter, I'll read verse 11. Dearly beloved, I beseech you as strangers and pilgrims, abstain from fleshly lusts, which war against the soul. Fleshly lusts. There are fleshly lusts we need to abstain from. In the world around us, there are corrupt practices we need to abstain from. In the world around us, then look what should be our attitude in verse 13. Submitting yourself to every ordinance of man, for the Lord's sake, whether it be to the king as supreme, or unto governors as them that are sent by him for the establishment or punishment of evildoers. The punishment of evildoers and for the praise of them that do well. He says we need to submit. In our places of work, we submit. Look at verse 18. Verse 18 tells us, servants, be subject to your what? To your what? To your what? Be subject to your own master. your manager, be subject to them. Be obedient to them. They don't necessarily need to be a Christian before you are subject to your own master. No, he says be subject to your own master with all fear, not only to the good and gentle, but also to the what? Forward, to the wicked one, to the one that is delaying you, that is ridiculing your work. You still need to be subject to her. You still need to be subject to him. She may not like your face. She may not talk well about you. But you still need to be subject to your own master. When he gives instruction, when she gives instruction, you need to be subject. That should be our conduct in our places of work. The Bible says every tree is known by its fruit. We born again Christians, we as pilgrims on the highway to heaven, are known by a lifestyle of honesty, by a lifestyle of industry, diligence, obedience, promptness in attending to details, by a lifestyle of faithfulness, commitment to our work, and contentment in our places of work. You are contented. Yes, what they are paying you may not be satisfying now, but yet you are still contented with that. You are giving glory to God for that as well. You are contented. We should manifest the character that marked us out as believers in our places of work. We are to please the Lord in our places of work. We are not to oppress, neither be insubordinate to our leaders. You know, neither be insubordinate to our managers in our places of work. We need to understand, many people today, they always mistake laziness for Christianity. Yes, God will answer your prayers. I didn't hear amen to that. God will answer our prayers, but yet he expects us to work. Yes, we are praying for a breakthrough. God will give us that breakthrough, but he expects us to go out there and do something with our hands. The Lord himself is going to bless us. When we give ourselves to work, when we give ourselves to diligence in our places of work, yes, they may not recognize us today, but eventually the Lord himself will reward us. What are the attitudes the Lord expects us to manifest in our places of work? Number one, honesty. We must be honest. Honesty. The managers may not be there with you all the time. Do your work. Do the work that at the end of the day, you'll be proud of what you have accomplished for the company that day. Use your brain. Be innovative, honesty. In your timekeeping, in your time writing, be honest. Number two, manifest holiness. That should be our conduct. Holiness is not only when we're in the church. We need to take holiness with us to our places of work. Take holiness with you, righteousness, be righteous. If you say you're a Christian, let them see by your lifestyle. Let them see by your conduct. Let them see by your behavior. Let them see by your attitude. Take holiness with you to that place of work. It's not only in the church. It's not only in the home. Take it with you. Number three, we should have the conduct of happiness. Let them see that joy in you. You're always happy, not moody all the time, not grumpy all the time. Not with a stony face all the time, always sorrowful. No. Christians, we are happy. Do you know that? The Bible says the joy of the Lord is what? Is your strength. Is your strength. I know of a particular believer, when he was leaving that job to another company, one of his colleagues told him and said, "My friend, do you know what? I'm going to miss your joy, the joy I always see on you every day. We need to demonstrate that. That should be our conduct. Yes, That job may be taxing. Be happy doing it. That joy may not be feasible. I have a status. Be happy doing it. Number four, there should be humility. Humility. Don't be proud. Be humble. Be humble. You may have more qualification than that to your manager. Yet be humble. You may be well educated than that your manager. Yet be humble. She is your manager. He is your manager. Be humble. Not allow pride into your life. Number five, let there be helpfulness. That should be our conduct. Be willing to help. Be willing to help. Let them see that you are an employee that is always, they can always rely upon to help. To help the organization. To help the individuals also in the company. That you care for people. As an employer, you care for people. You are willing to help them. It's not necessarily you giving money all the time. You can give counseling. You see someone, your fellow colleague, that is sorrowful. Show a little kindness to him. Show a little kindness to her. Be interested in their situation. Get into them. Be helpful. Be willing to help. Number six, you demonstrate the conduct of high spirit. You're always doing, you know, with that high spirit, enthusiasm. Always looking for, there are many people, when it is Sunday night, do you know that they just become unhappy? Why? Because Monday is coming. They have to go to work on Monday. No! Be of high spirit. Be excited to go to work every morning. Not that you wake up in the morning, you say, oh, I'm still going to this place of work again today. I hope I will survive it. No, go to that place of work with an high spirit, with enthusiasm, with excitement. That's the conduct which you are. Number seven, there should be heavenly mindedness. You know that as you are doing that work, the rapture might take place. You are conscious of heaven all the time. Conscious of heaven. Conscious of the rapture. Conscious of the coming of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. You are conscious of heaven. Number eight, the conduct of hard work. Hard work. Give it. Be diligent. Be hardworking. Let your employer see that in you. Let them see that in you, that they have a deadline to meet. You are giving yourself to it to meet that deadline. Number nine, the conduct of healthy living. Healthy living. You also maintain that because we are Christians, we are not careless with our health. Do you understand? And as we do all these things, the Lord Himself is going to reward us. I said the Lord Himself is going to reward us. We should do our work joyfully, fervently, and with all our heart. People should glorify God by our good conduct and Christian lifestyle in our places of work. When we do all these things, then this leads us to point three before we pray. Christ's commendation of the worthy. Christ's commendation of the worthy. Let's go back again to our text in Ruth chapter 2. Look at the commendation for Ruth. Boaz commended her. She received commendation from Boaz. Boaz is like the like of Christ. Do you understand? As Ruth got a commendation from Boaz, you will get your own commendation from Christ in Jesus' name. Ruth chapter 2, verse 12. Look at what the Bible says. The Lord recompense thy work. I didn't hear amen to that.
Amen.
The Lord will recompense thy work. Your employers may not see it today. That manager may be sitting on your promotion. That manager may be sitting on your increment in salary. But the Lord will recompense thy work. Do it as unto the Lord. Little is much. That songwriter says, when God is what? Is in it. Little. That little salary you are saying, oh, I'm earning little salary today, is not when God is in it. The Lord will recompense thy work. When you walk with your hands, the Lord will recompense thy work. When you walk with your brain, the Lord will recompense thy work. When you walk with all your mind and your heart is in that job, the Lord will recompense thy work in Jesus' name. Then it says, and a full reward be given thee of the Lord God of Israel, under whose wings thou hast come to trust. The Lord will give you your full reward.
Amen.
At the appointed time, you will get that promotion.
Amen.
At the appointed time, you will get that increase in salary.
Amen.
At the appointed time, you will get that recognition in that place of work in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Christ's commendation, look at it in Revelation chapter 3. Revelation chapter 3. Chapter 3 of Revelation. I'll read verse 4 of chapter 3 of Revelation. Look at the commendation of Christ of the world in verse 4. Thou hast a few names even in Sardis, which have not defiled their garments, and they shall walk with me in white, for they are what? For they are what? Worthy. You will be worthy. If we walk worthy of our calling as Christians in our places of work, if we avoid the ways of the people of the world, God will promote us above our colleagues.
Amen.
In our vocation, in our profession, in our occupation, in our places of work, the Lord wants us to walk worthy of Him. Like we are told in Ephesians chapter 4, verse 1, walk worthy of the vocation in which you are called. He wants us to walk worthy of Him. When we walk worthy of the Lord will bless us. If we are faithful, if we are dutiful, if we are fervent, if we are honest, if we are diligent, industrious in our places of work, we are punctual, we are prompt to duties, obedient and submissive in our places of work, the Lord will answer us when we pray for promotion.
Amen.
That promotion will come.
Amen.
It will grant us favor even before our employers.
Amen.
The Bible says, when a man's way pleases the Lord, he maketh even his enemies to be what? To be at peace with him. That manager that is so tough today, that woman that is so difficult today, that man that is sitting on you to trying to frustrate you in that place of work, the Lord is telling us today, if you go back and demonstrate the lifestyle of a Christian, the lifestyle of a believer in that place of war, the Lord Himself will fight for you.
Amen.
The Lord will answer your own prayers.
Amen.
You just be diligent. Just be dutiful. Do your work as you ought to do it. Attend to detail. Be faithful as a Christian in that place of war. Let your light shine. Let them see the conduct, the character of Christ in you. Then the Lord Himself will promote you.
Amen.
The Lord is telling us today, as a saint, be holy. As a Christian, be Christ-like. As a Christian, if you say you are a Christian, be Christ-like. As a salt of the earth, be purged. Let your salt, define its worth. Be purged. As a light, be true. In that place of hope, be honest. As an epistle, be legible. Let them see the life of Christ in you. As a soldier, be valiant. As a child, be obedient. In everything we do, the Lord is telling us, let your light so shine before men. In that place of work, let it shine. In your neighborhood, let it shine. Let righteousness, godliness characterize your life. Don't just leave your righteousness in the church. Don't just leave it as we just came back from the retreat. Just leave it with you at the retreat. Take it with you in that profession. Take it with you in that place of work. Take it with you in that campus. Take it with you everywhere you go, in your shopping mall. Live the life of a Christian, and the Lord will reward you.
Amen.
And the Lord will recompense you. And the Lord will bless you. Let's rise up and commit ourselves to the hands of the Lord in prayers. We want to talk to the Lord today that the Lord himself will help us. Be a light. Seeing the life of Ruth, demonstrate that life of a Christian. Live that life of a Christian. Let them see the light of God in you. The character of a Christian, let it be seen in you. Don't join in the evil, corrupt practices. The lying that takes place in the places of God, don't join them. The immorality that takes place in the places of God, don't join them. The iniquity that takes place in the places of God, don't join them. The dishonesty, unlawful gain that takes place in the places of God, don't join them. Be faithful. Be faithful. Give yourself to that work. Be diligent, my brother. Be diligent, my sister. Give yourself to the work. And the Lord himself will bless you. And the Lord himself will bless you. Manifest the conduct of a Christian. In that place of work, manifest the conduct of a Christian. Let them see the life of Christ in you. Let them see the conduct of a Christian in you. The honesty, let them see it in you. The holiness, let them see it in you. The happiness, the joy of the Lord in your strength, let them see it in you. The helpfulness, doing that joy with enthusiasm, with excitement, let them see it in you. Walking with heavenly consciousness, let them see it in you. Giving yourself diligent to that work, let them see it in you. And when you do that, God himself is going to promote you. God himself is going to reward you. God himself is going to bless your work. Give yourself, don't be idle. Find something to do. You don't have a white collar job, get something doing. Take that opportunity. Take that business. Do that thing. And the Lord himself is going to reward you. Let's talk to the Lord and ask for grace that we will live our life as we ought to live as Christians in our places of work.